One of the least popular, yet consistently harmful forms of pollution off U.S. coasts is nutrient pollution. Though many people commonly consider the bold effects of nutrient pollution, like red tides, an isolated incident happening elsewhere in the world, in reality, more than 60% of our coastal rivers and bays in the continental U.S. are currently degraded by this issue. Nutrient pollution is caused by an extreme excess of nutrients from land, like nitrogen and phosphorus, that eventually make their way into the ocean system via streams and rivers. The initial source of these runoff nutrients comes from a variety of anthropogenic uses on land, where they are especially useful in plant fertilizers, boosting growth and ensuring high crop yields. However, because these fertilizers are often cheap and not considered chemically unsafe, more is put into the soil than can actually be fixated by the plant's roots. So instead, the nutrients pool up in the groundwater, where the rain eventually transports them to the sea. And while these nutrients are naturally a very normal part of marine ecosystems, supporting the growth of microscopic plants called phytoplankton, this is a case where too much of a good thing is very bad. The consistent runoff of the nitrogen and phosphorus causes the phytoplankton populations to quickly bloom and explode in number. A common visual confirmation of eutrophication, or the nutrient-caused bloom, is a darkening of the water to a green, brown, red, or equally murky shade. If the nitrogen and phosphorus are in such excess and remain there, the bloom will continue to grow beyond a sustainable level, causing large numbers of bacteria to consume massive amounts of the phytoplankton at elevated numbers. Unfortunately, just like us, these organisms take part in the act of respiration, and consistently take up large amounts of oxygen during this feeding frenzy. If this process goes on long enough, the result will be an anoxic environment, one totally depleted of usable oxygen. Of course, this is a problem to fish, marine mammals, and any other organisms that require oxygen to live. And if they intend to remain in this environment, they will die. Our experiment was a simple simulation of the significant effects even small amounts of nutrients like nitrogen and phosphorus have on phytoplankton growth in our home estuary of Long Island Sound. We collected sound water and dosed half of the water samples with F over 2, a balance of nutrients comparable, if not slightly weaker, than those that enter the estuary on a daily basis. All the tanks, both dosed and not, were under constant light and controlled temperature. The bloom and phytoplankton population in the tanks with added nutrients happened much quicker than we thought. Within a week, there was a stark contrast between the clear, seemingly clean, control tank and the murky brown water of the tank with added nutrients. Under a light microscope, the bloom is especially significant, with counts of diatoms, a type of phytoplankton, approximately 50 times that of the control tank. There are also other indicators of the effect of phytoplankton population. Their common predator, the copepod, also had a boost in population, as evidenced by significant amounts of copepod molts. This indicated that the feeding rate had become exponential with the bloom. It could then be hypothesized that, if left in its current closed system, these tanks could eventually become anoxic and be totally depleted of life-giving oxygen.